particular film, Mary Paley. She is an incredible first-time filmmaker in Albany, New York. This has been her project for about 7 years. And she came to my wife Tracy and I and was like, I think this could be better. You know, I think that, you know, this needs another edit. So we sat down with her and for about 3 months, every day, we worked on it. And I think we turned it into something pretty special because it appeared on PBS up there and it made more money than any other program ever in the history of upstate PBS. It made $100,000 for the local PBS station. And then they had us do a sequel. So we have a sequel also to the film that also aired on PBS. So there's a lot of interest in this subject of urban renewal and eminent domain, and when the state displaces people and basically bullies them out of their homes and out of their lives, and they don't appreciate it.
So how did the project start?
Well, it started really with Mary's father. He is an amazing photographer for one of the newspapers up there, which is now defunct, called the Knickerbocker News. And he had just hundreds of amazing pictures of these Italian Americans, their life, and how they were displaced by the building of the Empire State Plaza. And it was for her, it was sort of, you know, always important in her house. She wanted to tell the story. She created a website, and then the website grew into a documentary, and then that grew into the neighborhood that disappeared.
And this was never really reported?
You know, it was kind of in the upstate area. It's sort of like a secret that nobody really talks about.
Because you know there's something wrong with Albany, but people don't know what.
Exactly. It's like when you go into the Albany and it has this sort of Buck Rogers look about it. There's just something cold and sort of uninviting about it. It's kind of cool at first, like, what is this? Why am I on the set of Blade Runner? And then it becomes sort of like some place that the people of Albany, they don't really use except like a couple of times a year. And it, the thing that most people don't realize is that 10% of the city was removed, like 15,000 people. I mean, 1,200 businesses. So much of really the ethnic heart. It would have been like New York City deciding that Brooklyn no longer is part of Manhattan. That's the equivalent of what they did.
The city completely changed after that.
Oh, well, there is when you're in Albany, there's sort of a sense of disconnection. You know, there's no sort of place where, you know, like in the village, you can sort of walk around and, you know, there's this melting pot.
Yes.
You know, in Albany in the 60s and, you know, the 50s and the 40s, there was, you know, African-American, Jewish, so many Italian-Americans, all these different people, all were kind of connecting with each other, and, you know, the businesses were dependent on each other. And now, the blight that is the Empire State Plaza really broke the city's heart, you know, and it broke sort of any sort of a sense of connection that you have in Albany. And that's what happens when an urban renewal happens without the people.
Yes.
And them making any decisions.
Yes, because that's what it feels when you watch the movie. It's a decision of one man.
Yes.
And it decides, like, it's almost very, you know, very narcissistic.
Well, I think with what we're seeing was sort of this rise of fascism and totalitarian ideas of one man, you know, that we're seeing, you know, politically. The power that can affect someone for generations and generations. These people who are in this movie still are in tears about the loss of their neighborhood. they feel like they were robbed of so much. And, you know, it was really important for Mary to sort of create this, where you fell in love with these people and you fell in love with their life and their lifestyle. And then here come the bulldozers, you know, and say, I'm sorry, you have to go somewhere else, and an entire way of life is lost. Sure, with time, there would have been a change, of course. But, you know, one of the things the mayor says in the movie is, cars in and cars out. That's what the Empire Plaza is. There's no connection between who works in the government and the people. They eat inside the plaza, they work inside the plaza, and then they go from the plaza. There's nothing where Albany is connected at all with, you know, the people, the thousands and thousands and thousands of people who work there.
There's also one thing that really is shocking in the movie is because they want this project to happen no matter what.
Right.
So they lie. They say this neighborhood has the highest birth rate.
Yes.
Yes. Could you talk a bit about that?
That was a powerful moment in the film. Because there was a political individual in the film, and the Mayor Corning, who was the mayor at the time, and he, you know, supposedly was, you know, fighting Rockefeller. But Rockefeller said, when he, for his vice presidential hearing, he said that there was the highest mortality rate, and that was something that they could check out. And literally, I mean, it was just nothing but a lie. Like only one baby had died, you know, in 1 year, and two in another. I mean, the idea that that was a slum, that, you know, the power of this film is, when you're doing a documentary, it's not my job to tell you what to feel. You know, I feel like when we're editing this together, we just want to show you what existed. And if you fall in love with that, does that look like a slum to you? You know, do those beautiful, beautiful buildings that they described, you know, the majestic staircases, you know, the brass fittings, does that sound like a slum to you? And what you had there is a lot of prejudice, too, that really was not expressed with the fact that these were not, you know, Anglo-Saxon, you know, Americans. These were a group of people who could not fight for themselves. There was nobody who was there to stay. And the Mayor Corning, who said that he was going to fight it, once he found out that he couldn't fight it, he went out and he made the money that he could off of it, you know, off of the insurance. And, you know, some would say he might have gotten some things like the museum or the performance center, but I think a lot of people in Albany would have been much, much better off without this sort of marble monstrosity, and instead a neighborhood that they could love and cherish forever.
Do you think he killed the soul of Albany and he hasn't wasted?
Well, hopefully he didn't kill the soul, but I think that he killed a way of life. He killed the natural way that Albany would have developed as a city.
I haven't been there, so I don't.
Right. Know. Well, I understand. No. So
I heard strange thing about Albany. I haven't been there, but you heard strange.
Right.
Thing.
Right. Yeah. Yes. most of what people know about Albany is that whenever they watch a Law and Order episode and somebody says that you have to go to Albany, the other people roll their eyes like, "Oh God."
Yes. Exactly.
Really? Do I have to go to Albany? Yeah. It's, you know, Albany has some wonderful things going for it, but unfortunately it lacks identity. And what gives something identity are the people and sort of the ethnics and the quality and the culture. And once that was removed from the city of Albany, I think Albany is constantly struggling to try to find out what it is again, instead of just the seat of government.
Okay, thank you. We're gonna have a Q&A later. So
great.
Is there anything you would like to add about the movie? That
No, I just want to say, thank you so much to the Socially Relevant Film Festival. I have known about it since its first year. Nora is a great, great friend. I'm so appreciative of the opportunity to be part and show people movies and stories maybe they haven't never had a chance to see before. Thank you so much to Mary Paley for giving me the opportunity. And go check out The Neighborhood That Disappeared and its sequel, Echoes from The Neighborhood That Disappeared.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Great.
Thank you. And we love you.